Welcome to our August edition of Homewijn, the women's edition that was brought to you in Prohibition, or just after Prohibition. And I'm sure we're all glad that it's over.
Yes.
And that we can sit at Wijn again and have a glass of wine and chat to a great and very interesting winemaker, Samantha Suddons. Thank you for joining us this evening and for hosting our Women's Edition virtual tasting.
Thank you. Very happy to be here.
So this evening we are going to taste a really interesting selection of wines, which we selected specifically from five different female winemakers who we have also profiled in our newly launched Tastemakers series, the Women's Edition, that you will see come out over the next couple of weeks, where we chat to and we profile some amazing females in the wine industry. But without further ado, Samantha, welcome to Wijn.
Thank you, it's lovely here. It's nice to be out the house in a wine bar, it feels like home.
So maybe to kick us off this evening, tell us a little bit about where you come from. Definitely not from South Africa,
judging the accent
by your
gives it away. Yeah.
Tell us a bit about where you come from, how you got into the wine industry, and what brought you here today.
Great. Well, I first came to South Africa on holiday and fell in love with the beautiful country. I was touring some wine farms and meeting people behind the scenes at wineries, and kind of the passion that everyone was, you know, relaying was just so kind of intoxicating, excuse the pun, and it just really invigorated me to dig deep into wine and where does it come from, how does it grow, instead of just something that you drink and have on the table and it goes with dinner. Look towards more the land and seeing behind the scenes. So I had no experience in wine besides from drinking it. I moved to South Africa in 2010, literally with a backpack. I lived in the backpackers in Stellenbosch for 6 weeks because I had not thought that part through. I was 21. And then I started studying with the Cape Wine Academy. It was a really good place to start off, getting a base on and a handle on South African wines and learning more about the regions here first and foremost. And then I studied with the Wine and Spirits Education Trust, so a more international kind of global outlook on the wine scene around the world. And most importantly, just getting stuck in, hands-on, working at wineries, working at restaurants, tasting rooms, farms, trying to cover all the bases of what the wine industry is about until I realized that my passion really lay in the farming and to the winemaking side of the wine industry. So after 6 years of working at other wineries, then with a business partner, I started a new business venture based in the Swartland region. So that's where I am now.
Right. And I mean, I can definitely say it's a real inspiration to see a woman and anyone enter the wine industry and make wine that didn't study wine.
Yeah.
And that really came from loving wine, decided to immerse yourself in the industry, and really made sure that you built up the knowledge and the taste profile to be able to ultimately make wine.
Yeah, I think it's important to understand like what angle of the wine industry appeals to you. Because I know a lot of people start in the service industry and then further from that get really interested in the production side. So that's kind of the journey that I took from it as well. And I've always been interested in farming and especially organics and learning about biodynamic practices in the vineyard and in the winery as well. So it was kind of that holistic approach that really appealed to me as well. And then it's just really great to drink and enjoy and share with people and talk about. So there's the social aspect of it too, the cultural part, traveling around and meeting people all over the world. There's just so many different aspects to the wine industry that make it just so enjoyable. And when you're doing something that you enjoy and that you love, it's easy to wake up every morning and get stuck into it. Yeah, even the admin side.
Great. Yeah, so this evening, as I said, we have a really interesting lineup of wines. So we will kick off with the Brookdale Estate, Mason Roach Chenin Blanc, which I will pour for us now. So Brookdale, a pole-based estate that was bought over by also by a British man called Tim Rudd. And he basically renovated the farm, redid it, planted a whole new block of vineyards, and started off by making a Chenin Blanc, the Brookdale Estate Chenin Blanc, and then introduced this Mason Road Chenin, which is the, more of their entry level wine. So maybe talk us a little bit through what your opinion is of the wine, what you smell, what you taste.
Yeah, so for me, this is a really quintessential Chenin Blanc. If you were to read the tasting notes of a Chenin Blanc, this ticks all the boxes. It's got the tropical fruit notes, the guava, the papaya. Those are really good calling cards for what a South African or a New World Chenin Blanc tastes like. It's like, as I said, quintessential. And then it's also got a really nice lively acidity. It keeps it fresh, it keeps it light. It's definitely an entry-level wine, or an easy drinking wine I should say, but that has the appeal too. Not every wine has to be so serious or heavy or something that you have to wait years down the line to drink. You can just open this straight away, you can smell it's so aromatic, it's floral, it's juicy, it's ready to drink and enjoy. So that really appeals to me, just a really, you know, pleasant, easygoing, easy drinking Chenin Blanc.
And Chenin Blanc is a cultivar. Why does it do so well in South Africa in general?
It's such an interesting grape because it shouldn't really, in theory, work here in South Africa. It's a grape that comes from a cool region in France, the Loire, but it's so widely spread here in South Africa. It's just adapted to all the different climates of South, well, microclimates of South Africa, the different soils. So it does well on granite soils, sandstone, schist soils. So it's really been adaptable. It has so many different personalities. And now people are starting to realize with Chenin Blanc that even just across the hill, or down the hill or across the valley, that each vineyard is showing such different personalities and characteristics. So it's such a grape that is able to kind of form to its location and show such intense personality without any major influence or interference. With this, you know, there's no heavy oaking like you would do with an oak Chardonnay. It really just shows its personality so easily, and it's so expressive. So Chenin has become like the signature grape of South Africa, just because wherever it grows, it seems to just be so happy, it's versatile. It ranges all the way from the fruitier side, which we're tasting now, to the more mineral and saline side of some more of the older vineyards that you get with Chenin Blanc too. So yeah, it's got a really positive future here in South Africa too. I mean, it's been doing so well all of this time, so the future's only going to be looking better when people start to narrow down the single vineyards or the really excellent sites as well.
And you told me in one of our previous conversations that you also did a little bit of work with Rue Sacre earlier in your career in sort of identifying the old vine Chenins. Tell us a little bit about that and sort of how you experienced working with the farms and phoning them up and saying, oh, do you still have this vineyard?
That was, So in the beginning of the old vine project, it was just Rosa, Yolandi, who also you actually interviewed myself, and we would be sitting at a kitchen table and we'd be going through a spreadsheet of farm names, numbers, and what potentially they had on their farmers, vineyards older than 35 years old. So we were literally calling these farmers and being like, do you have these 3 hectares of Chenin Blanc? And they'd be like, how'd you get our number? Who is this? And it was really hard to kind of get the information. Sarvis were also in the beginning very kind of hesitant to share the details. But then everybody came to realize that the more information and the more sharing, the better it was for the whole wine industry, and actually to have such a positive spin on protecting the vineyards. And the farmers who just thought, oh, those old vines in the corner that they don't pay attention to, now they can taste the wine that's coming from the old vines. There's so much passion going into the farming and the protection of these vineyards. So it's completely done a turnaround where people were just really, you know, not paying attention to the old vineyards to actually now being something that's celebrated, that people are proud of, from the farmer to the winemaker to the farm workers who have been trained in old vine pruning, in composting. So it's been a completely such an amazing project that has covered all aspects of winemaking and farming. So that's been an amazing project, and now people get to taste old wines from around South Africa and of Chenin, for example, and compare vineyards, you know, on different soils with the same age, but they're in different areas. So it really enables people to see the potential of what happens here when you have a vineyard that's getting mature and showing so much more different personality than, say, a young vineyard too.
Great, so our next wine in the lineup is the Kakibos 2018 vintage from Thistle and Weed, which is a straight Verdejo. The 2019 vintage is blended with a little bit of Chenin Blanc as well, but this is a straight Verdejo. And Verdejo isn't a cultivar that many people know well in South Africa, a straight Verdejo.
That's what really kind of struck me when I tasted this wine, because Verdejo is used mainly as a blending component here in South Africa. So to have a single Verdejo on its own is very unusual. So it was interesting for me. You know, there's always so much to learn and to taste from different wines. And then I did a little digging around and I read that this is from old vines, it's a single block. So here we're tasting one grape on one plot of land. I think it was the Helderberg, was it? Stellenbosch. So yeah, it's a cooler climate of Stellenbosch. So to me, this wine speaks a lot more of texture and weight. And not all wines are aromatic and kind of punchy and on the nose, but this wine has it all on the palate for me. It's so much going on with the weightiness. There's oiliness in a good way, like length, viscosity. The nose is there. You get a little bit of a waxy macadamia and almond aroma for me, which was really interesting, and like lemon pith. Again, this is a wine I think this could benefit from a couple more years of aging, but for now, what you can really taste is that mouth coating feel from the wine and that real kind of richness and elegant texture.
Yeah, and Stephanie Veed started Thistle and Weed, I think, 3 years ago when she was still one of the winemakers at Fairview, and then started her own label and then went on her own about 2 years ago. And the Khaki Boss was a new addition to their portfolio last year. So the 2019 is only the second vintage of the Khaki Boss.
Now, this would be a really fun wine to have in a blind lineup, because I think everyone would go through all the guesses of different grape varieties, different areas, until someone would say Verdejo from Stellenbosch. So it's definitely a unique wine. It's my first time having it too, so I was obviously really interested in kind of digging deep into the flavors and the aroma of the wine as well, and just getting to know it, because as we just mentioned, it's very rare to have a Verdejo single grape variety on its own in South Africa.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, moving on to the red.
Yes.
So the first red that we will be tasting is from Frieda and List, which is, I think, probably one of the most well-known wine farms in the Paarl area. Beautiful farm. Beautiful homestead. They have quite a broad range of wines, of which the Ella is a new addition with the Syrah Grenache Viognier blend. The winemaker Frieda en List, Carla Nell, she started there as assistant winemaker and then took over from Susanne as head winemaker 2 years ago. And also spent some time in Italy making wines there, so definitely an interesting influence in the Frieda en List wines.
And it's an interesting blend of Syrah Grenache and Viognier, and again, that's quite an interesting topic, is to have a white grape in a red blend, which is not very usual here in South Africa. It's much more common in the Rhone and the south of France. And it's hard to kind of get right here in South Africa, because Viognier can be heavy and punchy and weighty and can kind of dominate the red grapes. But here I found it really pleasant and very well balanced. You're getting a lot of the smoky aromas from the Syrah and some of the strawberry and cherry from the Grenache. So together those are really balanced by a little bit of the texture from the Viognier. So I found this blend really interesting. No kind of heavy wood or anything too tannic or dominant about it. It was just really easy drinking as well. So nice. I would find this wine actually really enjoyable in summertime too, because now it's a bit chilly in here. It's actually quite cool, the wine. Like room temperature right now in winter is quite chilly. Yeah. So it's actually enjoyable when it's a little bit cooler as well. So maybe Curran's also influenced a little bit by those southern Italian red wines, where you can have them slightly chilled, because I found this really similar in that sense. Even though the grape varieties don't come from that region, I can see the kind of appeal of this being a very food wine, like bowl of pasta on the table, especially in like these tumblers. It just seems so nice, and like the bottle will disappear before you know it.
And tell us a little bit about using Viognier in blending with red wine? So why would you use a white to blend with two red cultivars?
Yeah, so in theory the Viognier would bring freshness and fruitiness. Mm-hmm. So in the Rhone, for example, the Viognier vines are usually interplanted within the red grape variety. So when they harvest the vineyard all at once, it's a basket full of red grapes and white, and a few white grapes in between, and then it gets co-fermented together. Most of the time in South Africa, I can't speak for this one, but usually people are blending afterwards and tasting the components. So the Viognier here would, my guess would be bringing that kind of freshness and liveliness to the wine, and making it a little bit more easier drinking and accessible in a younger age, as we find with most white wines, that kind of freshness, that zestiness. So that for me, the Syrah and the Grenache are doing all the work on the nose, the spicy and smoky and fruit aromatics, but then on the palate you get that Viognier, a little bit of a peachiness you get from Viognier, I find, and floral notes too. So it just kind of lifts up the wine a little bit, and that complements the easy drinking nature of the wine that I find as well.
Yeah, it's quite an easy drinking wine.
Yeah.
Lots of it.
Yeah, for sure. It's like, it's definitely, it's really nice to have a wine that you can just open. You know, there's something to be said about wines that, yes, you age and you keep them for 10 years and then they show their true potential. But at the same time, you know, you just want to open a bottle of wine and not overthink it. As I said, like, have a last night when I tasted this wine, I had it with a bowl of pasta and it was just like, that worked perfectly. It was just such a nice combination and just, you know, it is what it is. It's fruity, it's easy drinking, and that for me, you know, it ticks all the boxes. So.
Good.
Yeah.
So next wine, I think probably definitely the most interesting wine in the selection which we have.
Yeah.
The Smiley Red, which this vintage, well, non-vintage, this version has just been launched.
Yes.
And the interesting thing about this wine, obviously non-vintage, usually something which is used with MCC or champagne.
Yeah.
And then it also doesn't show what cultivars is.
No, exactly.
In it, which when I chatted to Ryan when he dropped off the wine, he said, well, it's part of the appeal. Mm. You don't want people to be influenced by what the cultivar is in the bottle.
Yeah,
you
exactly.
Rather just want them to drink wine from a specific region.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, it's not every day you get a sheep head on a label as well. So, you know, you're in for something a little bit different here. So the idea with the Smiley is to have, as you just mentioned, a red wine from the region and to work with grapes that maybe aren't so popular or common and no one really knows the name of them or what kind of characteristics they show on the nose or the palate. And that really isn't the important thing. The important thing is that you're tasting here more of the region, so the Swartland region, and working here with Cinso, Mouvedre, Carignan, Tinta Barocca. I mean, these are grapes that people just are like, you know, over the head of a lot of people. And it's interesting, you know, to tell people that those are the grapes, but that's not the be-all and end-all of the wine. The be-all is like, this is a Swartland red wine, it's a wine of the region, it's a non-vintage, so it's crossing over different vintages and different years, so that allows some blending and to create a wine that's more balanced. So that's just the fun part of the blending and the making of this wine as well, and also to make a wine that is ready to drink, as we were just talking about. There's something nice about being able to open a wine, drink it straight away, not overthink it, and just have something that's enjoyable, pleasant, and is easily accessible. I mean, I also don't like opening a wine thinking, oh, I should have opened it last night, or now I have to decant it and I have to wait. And there's nothing wrong with having an easy drinking wine or a really serious wine. You know, there's something for everyone there and for every meal, every occasion.
So I reckon this wine will challenge most people according to what they would expect. What do you get on the nose?
Yeah, so for me, like, the Smiley is always a very herbaceous wine.
Yes.
Like fynbos, it's quite, kind of what we'd say garrig, which is like wild herbs. Mm. And that's so interesting because it's coming from vineyards that are kind of high up on the Paardeberg, and they are bordering the natural fynbos, and they're kind of scattered around the Swartland. So that's just really a peculiar but very interesting aroma that I get across all the Smileys. It's really herbaceous, pungent, sometimes like a hibiscus tea, if you've had like a hibiscus like that really kind of red currant as well. And it's just, I always get like a sense of purity on the wine because there's no heavy oaking. Most of the wine is aged in concrete or in stainless steel. So what you're getting is the flavors and the aromas of the fruit and the area and the terroir than any sort of extra influence from the winery. So it's all natural fermentation. There's no fining or filtering. So everything's left to settle in the tank or in the barrel. So it's really, really hands off. And that to me, you know, you're transitioning what you're getting in the vineyard into the bottle with as little interference as possible. So natural acidity, it's literally just fermented grape juice. And that's what makes it fun and exciting. And maybe also the challenging part for people because people, you know, you don't pick up those aromas of chocolate and vanilla that come from the wood or, you know, with a Bordeaux blend where you get these earthy kind of mulchy aromas. It is kind of brutally honest, and that's what we love about it, is that it is what it is. It's not trying to be a soft or easy drinking wine in the kind of mainstream way. Yeah, it's just a really fun wine to make as well.
And do you? Because it's non-vintage, which is an interesting concept for wine. Because if you make a wine, there's specific vintage delivers specific types of grapes based on, you know, the conditions of that year. Mm. But if it's non-vintage, do you try and make a specific style? Or how do you choose which grapes you use and sort of what it ends up like?
Yeah. I'd love to say there was a theory in everything, but there's like, you know, there's method in the madness. It kind of all comes together each time at blending and tasting. And the way the non-vintage came about is that each grape variety benefits from a different length of aging in the cellar. So for example, the Tinta Barocca, it's usually used for port production. So it's really an intense grape, it's inky colored, it's high in tannin. So that needs a few more years in the cellar to kind of soften and age. Whereas Cinsault, you can make a Cinsault 4 or 5 months after harvest, release it, and it's easy drinking, fruity. So each grape needed a little bit more, you know, a different treatment in the winery, rather than pushing them through like, okay, this is a 2018 and that's all the grapes together from 2018, because there's just not really the harmony that, you know, the grapes aren't ready at the same time in the winery. So the blending each year comes from just tasting all the different batches and from what's available, making the most balanced and well, best wine we can out of all of the components. Yeah. So there's no idea going into it that it's going to be a Syrah-led blend or a Cinsault-led blend, or one year is going to be more dominant than the other in the blend. It literally just goes through tasting all the components, blending them together and saying, out of everything we've got, this year when we're bottling, that's the best option from everything.
Yeah.
And then the same thing year after year, that's how it works. Just taste, blend.
Yeah. It's a really interesting wine, I must say.
Yeah. And I think also with a wine like this, I mean, you know, I get a lot of emails or messages and people are like, oh no, it tastes so close or there's something wrong with it. And I say to people, no, give it a day, wait till the next day, then it will change and then it will change again. And I find with the Smileys, with both of the wines, that they just evolve over a few days because all of the different components are showing at different times. You know, as I mentioned, some need a little bit more air, some are a bit more shut down. So it really is a wine that kind of, as you're tasting it and as the days go on, or if you're having different foods with it, it really does kind of adapt and it changes you as you're going through it. But this is also another point of why I actually don't like to decant wines. I like to taste them from the start of the bottle, as long as I'm tasting them slowly, and see them evolve. Because if you decant it, then you're just trying to make the wine taste drinkable more quicker. Yes. Whereas with this, you know, taste a bit tonight, put a cork in it, try wait till tomorrow, taste it again, and then you'll have a different experience with it too. Yes. You know, you might feel different, you might be eating something different, your day's been different, the weather's different. So you get a different response from the wine too, and that I find with natural wines as well, they're completely changing and evolving all the time. And that's the beauty of a natural wine as well, or a low intervention wine, is that they're really receptive to being open and all the different experiences kind of around you as well.
It's good. Thanks. Great. Our next wine is from Sain, which is a beautiful winery. Yeah. We visited it last week. in Malchus, yeah. It's quite a drive. You drive on this like really hectic dirt road.
Yeah.
And you arrive there and it's just the most magical place. I must say, like, the place and the people and the vineyards, yeah. And everything just made such an impression on me. And the soils are unbelievable.
Yeah.
Because it's one part are these like river pebbles, yeah. Almost ronde klip.
Yeah.
And then it goes down and it becomes shale. And you have these bush vines planted everywhere.
It looks surreal. It looks surreal. Vines on Mars or something.
It's unbelievable. It's one of the most amazing places I've been. And the wine, through all the wines that they make, you smell and you taste the earth.
Definitely.
So for me, that was really quite exceptional. And to also just experience the way that they make the wine. So everything is done by hand.
Yeah.
Literally pruning, mulching, picking, sorting the wines right there in the vineyard after it's been picked. And then in the cellar, also everything done by hand. The bottles are bottled, labeled, waxed. Literally packed in the cellar. There's no forklift. Everything is packed by hand right up to the roof. So every single bottle of Saint wines goes through the hands of the six people that work.
It's amazing. Yeah. It's
So this low profile red is made. It's a blend made from
the Syrah and Trincadera.
Yes. Syrah, Mourvèdre, Dariga National, and Trincadera.
Yeah.
And it's the wines that don't go into the signature red blend. Ends up in the low profile. And I mean, again, interesting cultivars, but all of them Mediterranean varietals, which are obviously suited to the soils in that area.
Yeah, for sure. This is a really interesting wine and obviously a new region now in South Africa that's what you would say a monopole. So it's one producer in the area on their own producing these wines. So to taste wine from this area, you know, this is it here. And as you mentioned, like, because everything's so hands off, you know, without the interference with heavy oaking or additives, you really are tasting the place here, and that's really an amazing thing. So that for me, then on this wine, when I first tasted it, that I got this amazing smokiness and very iron, like charcuterie aroma from it as well, like this iron, cured meat aroma. So I'm thinking that's probably coming from the Syrah being dominant. Yes. And then the Portuguese varieties, I mean, they're always such a vibrant colour to the wine. Yeah. So you always see this like bright purple hue from Tarriga Nacional is a grape that really interests me actually. Because it's well suited to hot climates. So you can see here that their, you know, intention of planting these cultivars, again, not necessarily popular cultivars like Trincadera and Syrah is more popular, but more suited to the climate. So looking at what works in the soils, what works for that terroir, what works for that region. So it's really interesting to see some Portuguese varieties, you know, really playing their part in the blend here.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's got a concentration to the wine and this depth that you can feel on the palate. And the tannins are so fine. So it's not this dry tannin where you're like, oh wow, the wine's too heavy. It's just this pleasant kind of bite on the wine that gives it some width, that gives it some grip. So a lot of those Portuguese varieties have super thick skins that help obviously with the heat and with drought conditions. But then you get this really kind of powdery tannin from the grapes and as we said, the color as well, but you can feel that there on the structure of the wine. So again, like a really great food wine for me, this with like red meat sort of vibe as well. I was just like, imagining like piri piri Portuguese style, you know, like getting carried away with ideas of cooking.
Yeah, the Tarriga Nacional almost adds a savory undertone.
Exactly. And you get also a herbaceousness as well. I found as we were talking about the Smiley, I mean, there's Tinta Barroca in there, and you find a lot with the Portuguese varieties as well. This kind of almost a stemminess, that herbaceous, that crispness as well, that kind of crunch that you get on the wines, and it brings that freshness and that kind of, what I'd say, tautness to the wines as well. This wine's not kind of loose or flabby. It's like, it's really solid and just, it's got a beautiful structure to it as well.
Yeah, yeah, so the farm was bought by David de Trafford. And then he saw the soils and he just realized,
oh,
this is made.
Yeah. And no wonder everything's done by hand, because if you try to get a tractor or anything in those soils, it would be impossible.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
I mean, the day when we were there, Duncan Savage was actually there busy mulching on this Tariga National vineyard, and it was such a mission to, they literally put compost on every single bush vine.
Yeah.
And then they had a tractor go in, like,
try and get it through.
Yeah, it's insane.
Yeah.
But I mean, the vineyards, it's planted quite far from each other. So I mean, the yield must be like super low.
Yeah, yeah. I'd be actually interested to see there, because with younger vineyards as well, you've obviously got the benefit of the vigor from the young vines, but with the soil and the terrain being so hardy and kind of inhospitable, it must be interesting to see what they get off of the vineyards. But it's a really, I mean, for anyone who's interested in wines, again, this would be great to blind people, because you know, you'd name every region in South Africa until you would think of Malchus, and then you'd think of every grape until you would get to some of the Portuguese grapes that are part of this blend. So it's definitely a fun wine to blind to your friends and try catch people out.
Yeah, it's interesting, because after having been there and having seen the place and the vineyards and the soils, you can almost taste all of that in the wine.
Yeah.
I think after having experienced it, I reckon you would probably be able to pick a sane wine and for blind tasting.
That's actually a good point, because that's the point, you know, of terroir and actually making the wines in the way of being hands-off and, you know, no additives and no heavy oaking or influence from the winemaking side. Because now in a lineup, you know, people will start to pick up a wine from those regions because they are showing themselves as purely as possible.
Yeah.
So there's definitely something to be said about that. So in, you know, 5-10 years time, you know, maybe we'll all be able to say that's a Malchus, and I'm sure we will, because as time's gone on and now people say that's a Swartland Syrah or that's a Stellenbosch Cabernet, it's just a matter of time until people can say, wow, that's a flavour that you identify with that specific terroir.
Yeah.
So that's really exciting.
Yeah, and it's quite interesting because, I mean, the properties sit right almost on the embankment high up, and you've got the Breda River running down there. So you would think they have access to a lot of water, but they actually don't.
Yeah.
Because a lot of the salt from the ocean actually pushes up into the river, and they can't use that water to irrigate the vines.
Yeah.
So that was quite interesting. And you almost also have a natural saltiness in the soils, which does come through in the wines.
Yeah, salinity, exactly. Yeah, it's definitely got that kind of briny texture. It's actually just reminded me of what I was tasting last night when I was tasting the wine, but that black olive brine, like that jar, and that now I remember that coming out after the wine had been open for some time. So again, it's another wine that really starts to show itself after, you know, swirling, tasting, going back to it. And that's a lovely calling card of the grape Syrah, is that black olive brine, that kind of pepperiness as well.
Cool. Okay, our last wine is the Frieda & List Artisan Range Malbec. So this is, they've made a Malbec for quite some time, but this is Caroline's first Malbec that she's made in the Artisan Range specifically. And the grapes come from their farm, just outside Paarl. So Malbec, again, not a varietal that South Africans know quite well as a single variety.
Yeah, I mean, it's big in Argentina, so they've kind of taken the lead with the global runners of being Malbec producers. Yes. Here it's used in Bordeaux-style blends, so it is a official Bordeaux grape variety. Yes. It goes, and even in Bordeaux, it's not hugely popular, so it has become much more known as being a New World grape because of the Argentinian influence. So here it's really interesting, again, to have a grape in South Africa that's not necessarily shown on its own. It usually does the work in a Bordeaux-style blend. But you can highlight the grape on its own and see the characteristics of, okay, what is a Malbec and what are the what are the aromatics, what's the flavor profile of it.
And the color for me of a Malbec is just so beautiful. It's almost like this deep purple, maroon type of color.
No, definitely as well. And I always find like the Bordeaux grape varieties like have a little bit more of that kind of ruby color, a little bit more of that red color, whereas the southern grape varieties have for me, like as we were just seeing with the Portuguese grape, that purple, like bright, it's almost midnight, like magenta, like bright color. So yeah, it's got this kind of beautiful blush color on the edges too. But for me here, the nose, I mean, it's like the minute you smell it, you're like, okay, that's a Bordeaux grape variety. Yes. You can smell it's earthy, it's mulchy, it's got a little bit of that kind of, a little bit of the green pepper, but nothing too pungent or overwhelming. It's just that's the grape variety and that's what you get from it. I found it to be very elegantly made as well. Like, again, nothing too heavy on the palate or out of balance. And it's only a 2017, so then it's going to, you know, it's going to go places after a few more years. But even now, after a few years, it's already showing beautifully.
And what I love about Malbec is on the palate, you get lovely sweetness as well. So it's almost a really nice balance of getting like green peppers on the nose.
Yeah.
And then you get a bit of sweetness on the palate, which is really beautiful. Mm.
And then
almost like that deep cherry.
Yes, yeah, lots of cherry as well, and cassis, like that blue fruit flavors as well. But what I find really interesting about this one as well, out of all the wines we tasted, is like you can feel that tannic grip like on your palate and the length of the wine too. So you can see that this is a wine that will benefit from some aging or will really pair well with some food, because you've got that juicy plush mouth sensation, which, you know, with food it's just going to open up more and more as well.
And maybe just to wrap up an interesting point, because I think a lot of the, let's call it, new world winemakers tend to focus on the lesser known varietals and not necessarily your more traditional varietals.
Yeah.
Why is that?
I think, well, sometimes it's basically all new winemakers can get their hands on. They have to find the weird and wacky vineyards out there. But also I think it's just about, you know, pushing the boundaries a little bit, trying new things, you know, especially with the younger generations who have maybe traveled more and experienced and tasted, and they come back, not just to South Africa, to whichever country, and they think, okay, let's try Touriga Nationale here and see what happens. Whereas 30 years ago, it was very much, you know, a list of grapes that worked in South Africa and people stuck to that. And I think it's people just wanting to, yeah, as I said, push the boundaries, take some risks, try new things, and you just never know what's going to work. You know, as we talked about earlier, Chenin Blanc in theory comes from, you know, a cold region in the north of France, but in South Africa it just flourishes and it does so well. So who's to say there's not a great variety out there that we haven't yet planted in South Africa that's going to be amazing and has such potential. So it's really exciting to see what people are busy planting, what great varieties, and I think that also it speaks to, you know, the mindset of people going forward and for the future, that people aren't thinking, oh, I'm going to make a Merlot just because it says Merlot on the label and I know I can sell it well. People are thinking about what grapes suit the terroir, what grapes will work in 50 years when maybe it's a couple of degrees warmer in the area because of global warming or there's a drought. So people are thinking practically, but also just trying to, like, you know, push the net out and see what's out there and bring it back. And then, yeah, it's exciting, and you just wish you had a lot more time to experience like all of the different grapes that are out there and taste everything. But, you know, as the years go on and people try new things, it just gets more and more exciting. So I think it's everyone's need and desire to want to experiment and just try as much that they can and see.
And maybe just to wrap up, when we can travel again and travel abroad, where's the first destination that you want to go to?
Well, it's definitely Italy. Well, I should say England to visit my parents, but it's going to be Italy. I was actually supposed to be going to Italy now to harvest in the south of Italy. So I had my harvest all lined up, but obviously, yeah, with lockdown, can't go. And I've got family in Italy as well, so it's nice to go visit them. But definitely Italy, it's for me, you know, the combination of food, wine, the people, people. So yeah, England to see my family, Italy for the wine.
Oh, great. To all of you that joined us for this tasting, thank you so much for your support, for subscribing to our Homewijn selection every month. If you're not a subscriber yet, you can go to wijnbar.co.za and sign up for our Homewijn monthly box. We look forward to seeing you next month for our next virtual tasting, and to hopefully see all of you back here at Wijn soon.
Yes.
Cheers.
Yes. Cheers.